Record.
Good morning, everyone. Today we are continuing our study of repentance. And so last Lord's Day, we talked about repentance, and today we'll talk about repentance just a little bit more. And I'll just go over very briefly what we are doing. We're talking about what God wants, being what God wants. And so we're basically, when we talk about being what God wants, we're talking about the inside. What does God want on the inside? And because that's going to affect the outside. And we're going to see that today. And so when we look at this series, this is series subject number 5, when we talk about this idea of changing our mind about God. And the word for that, technical word for that, is repentance. And very briefly, we'll talk about basically what we talked about last Lord's Day, and then we'll add to that more practical information today about changing our mind about God and about sin. And so we talked about last Lord's Day that preaching Christ, what it does is it convicts people of sin. And we saw this in several passages throughout God's word. This is what convicts people of sin. This is, in fact, the Holy Spirit's work is to convict people of their sin. And then we saw that some very famous people, the very first words out of their mouth as recorded in God's word by the Holy Spirit is repent. And so we see that when he preached on the day of Pentecost, when the church started, when they said, what shall we do? What did he say? The first word was repent. John the Baptist, previous to him, when he came on the scene and began to preach, the first word out of his mouth was repent. When Jesus came on the scene and started his ministry, it was repent. And Paul, when he would go around preaching, he said, this is what God is commanding all people everywhere. So there are no exceptions, is it? That includes everyone. And so we see that this is a very important word. But we also saw that this word repent really is, it doesn't mean much to a lot of people today because they don't really even know what the word means. And what it means is to change your mind. It actually comes from a word that we get into English. And somehow, I don't know how we came up with the word repent. I'm pretty sure it's through translations and influences of Latin. But the word simply means to change your mind. So when Jesus, when the Holy Spirit told Peter what to say, basically when he was talking to those people, he said, change your mind. That, you see, you can understand that. And John the Baptist, when he came on the scene, he was telling people, change your mind. Jesus, change your mind. And Paul says, this is what God commands everybody everywhere. You got to change your mind. And you see, that's a lot different than using this theological word that we throw around a lot today. And people don't really know, you know, it doesn't have much force to it, I don't believe. But change your mind, that's pretty direct, isn't it? And so that's what Jesus and Paul and John the Baptist and all of them said. And we also said that we're talking about is a change of mind about sin and about God. And we said, among other things, people are not what they think they are, but what they think they are. And we're going to get into that more today. And again, I'll repeat that. Think about that. People are not what they think they are, but what they think they are. And that's why Jesus and Peter and Paul and all of these, John the Baptist, they were all coming on the scene saying, you need to change your mind. You need to change your thinking. That's what you need to do. That's called repentance. So, and the reason I'll say the word repentance from time to time is because you're going to read it in these translations when you read the Bible. It's not really a good word, in my opinion. And some translations actually do it, but they're usually not well-known translations. They say, change your mind. And that is the force. That's exactly, in fact, what Jesus and Paul and all of them were saying. And so remember that. I'll say repentance some, because you need to know when you're reading the Bible and you read the word repent, this is what it means to change your mind, so that you can understand and appreciate what God is saying when you're reading your Bible and you come across that word. So how do we know that we have changed our mind? That's what we're going to get into today. The other we talked about last Lord's Day. But I want to know, how do we know that someone has changed their mind about something? A change of mind must lead to a change of behavior. If there's no change in behavior, that evidences that there's never been a change in your mind. Because what we do reveals the truth about what we think. Can you see that? And so that's why we're going to talk about this now. How do we know that we've changed our mind? John the Baptist comes along preaching repentance. He says, change your mind. But there's certain things that he pointed out that must accompany this repentance or this change of mind. And so let's just see what John the Baptist, he teaches us some wonderful truths about how to change your thinking. Let's listen to what he says are some of the evidences of it. First of all, confession. Now, the word confession, by the way, it's really an interesting word. This is another word. We throw these words out there. And again, you know, like repentance, and I don't believe it has much force. Change of mind has force. And confession, I don't think it has more force than the word repentance. But still, I want you to understand what the word confession actually means. That word literally comes from a word that has its homologeo. Logos is word or speech, and homo means the same. It literally means to say the same thing. Now, the same thing about what? Well, basically to agree. That's what confession is. It's to agree, and in this instance, with God about sin. You see, when you confess your sin, what you're doing, and this is what John the Baptist said, this is going to be one of the evidences that you've repented, you've changed your thinking, because now you're willing to say the same thing about your sin that God says about your sin. You're agreeing with God about your sin. And that's what confession is. And this is what John says is an evidence of repentance. How do we know? What should we do? This is what people came up to John the Baptist. What should we do? He says, well, number one, you need to confess your sins. You confess, you admit, you agree with God about your sins by naming the sin that you've committed and identifying it, you see, being very specific about it and about our rejection of it. So what we're saying is repentance is an attitude of mind, of thinking about God and about sin, to where we will say the same thing about our sin that God says about our sins. And naming our sin is very important because it helps us to understand it. You know, when you can't really tell what you've done, well, you know, that's kind of vague. Well, that's not helpful. But if I tell lies, why do I tell lies? Am I trying to hide something? And so when you name it, you see, sometimes you can be too insecure to face truth in maybe some area, and you don't want to go ahead and name it. And this is why a lot of people in their prayers just say, God, forgive me of my sins. They don't want to name it. They just want to be general and generic about it. But you see, we need to name our sins, and that helps us as well. And that's what John is talking about. He says, this is one of the evidences that you've changed your thinking about God and about your sin, that you've agreed with God and you've named your sin, saying that you agree with God, basically, about that sin. And so that's one of the things that he says accompanies and evidences a change of mind about God and sin. And another thing he said is fruit. You see, he says produce fruit in keeping with repentance. Repentance, a change of mind, must express itself in changed behavior patterns. And John was very specific about this. In fact, if you look at Luke chapter 3 there, you go into Luke chapter 3, there were three different people, three different classes of people that came up to John with a specific question. And they were the crowd. They were tax collectors. Now, tax collectors back then were basically, well, in John's setting, they were going to be Jews. And they and the Roman government was the world power, and they were Jews who were collecting taxes for the Roman government. And they had the Roman government's power behind them. And so generally, they weren't honest. They could collect more money than really they should have been collecting, and kept, you know, a lot of it, gave a lot to the Roman government like they were required to do, but then keep a lot of it so they could become very wealthy. They were greedy and dishonest, and the Jewish people hated them. In fact, they hated them so much, they said, you can't even go to church with us. You can't go in our synagogues. And so they were outcasts, but they were rich, you see. And so they were greedy. They wanted money, and they got money. And so John is going to talk to tax collectors as well. And then he's going to talk to soldiers. They're going to come up and say, hey, how do we evidence that we've changed our mind, that we've repented? What kind of behavior do we have to demonstrate to show that we've changed our mind? And so John's going to give a really good teaching about how you can tell you've repented or you've changed your thinking about God. First of all, he says, you evidence fruit by showing mercy toward others. So what should we do then? The crowd asked John. He replied, the man with two tunics should share with him who has none, and the one who has food should do the same. So the best indication, this is what John is saying, the best indication of our true attitude toward God, a change in thinking toward God, is our attitude toward people. Now, concerning judgment, the Bible says nothing about people being asked about their doctrinal beliefs. When you stand before God, we don't hear anything in Scripture that says, well, God's going to say, well, what did you believe theologically? What were your doctrinal beliefs? There, nothing like that. The Bible speaks entirely concerning people's behavior, because it's always our attitude toward behavior, our attitude toward other people that is going to, especially people who are less privileged than us, that's going to demonstrate our thinking about God and about sin. And we cannot and will not escape that for every single one of us. It is not that good works have been the cause of our salvation, but they are the effect of our salvation. The quality of our salvation is expressed, you see, in its effectiveness on how we treat other people. And I've had, you know, obviously, I've come to know, Dana and I have come to know the grace of God. And we've come to understand you're not saved by your works, you're saved by what Jesus did. It's through the obedience of one man, not us. That one man is Jesus Christ. And it's his work for us, not our work for him. And so I've had people email me, you know, who still believe like I used to believe and say, well, what about Matthew 25? You know, here are these people, this is a judgment day scene. And, you know, if they don't do these things, they're not going to be saved. Well, you see, this is what we're saying is this is the effect of salvation. It's not what saves them. It's the fruit of their salvation. You see, a tree that is healthy is producing fruit. And so, but it's the fruit is not making the tree alive. It's because the tree is alive that it produces fruit. It's because we're alive and been saved by the grace of God that we produce fruit. And it's not the other way around. You produce fruit and that'll save you, you see. So you have to explain this to people over and over again. I've had some people write me the same letter, I guess maybe forget they wrote it to me, you know, a year or two later. And but anyway, in the parable in Matthew 25 that some people bring up to me, it's the longest judgment parable in the New Testament. And the basis upon which the sheep, now the sheep are going to be saved and the goats are going to be lost. And the basis upon which the sheep are welcomed into the kingdom prepared for you, Jesus is going to say, since the foundation of the world was their good works. You see, that's what he says. Here's what, listen to what he says. He says, for I was hungry and you gave me something to eat, it should be. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. That's what Jesus is going to say to the sheep on the right hand that he's going to welcome into eternity, into heaven. Listen to what he says to those on the left, the goats, but they're going to hell. He says, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison and you did not look after me. You see, this is the whole point of the story that Jesus is giving here is that is to show our attitude to Jesus Christ, our change in thinking, our attitude, you see, is shown in our attitude toward other people. And the reality or otherwise of our repentance is seen in that area as well. And so, you know, when judgment, here's what Paul said. He said, I know whom, in whom I have believed. He didn't say, I know what I have believed. And that was just a few days before he was beheaded for Christ. Of course, he knew what he believed as well, but he knew that that's not the basis upon which he was going to be judged or saved. He said, I know whom I believed. It's a person. And when we accept, put our faith in this person, then our sins are forgiven, the Holy Spirit indwells us, and we produce fruit because we're alive. The tree is alive, it produces fruit. And so it's the effect of our salvation, our change of mind. It's the fruit of our repentance, which means a change of mind. And there's many passages like this in God's Word that talk about mercy and the way we treat other people. In fact, in our live service today, we read from Micah chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. This is a very famous passage, very great passage, of course. And here's what Micah, the prophet, preacher, asked. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Well, that's pretty good. What do I present to him? You know, what am I going to do? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? That's what they were commanded to do. Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression? The fruit of my body for the sin of my soul to offer my children? Will that please the Lord? He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. Okay, what is it? And what does the Lord require of you? That's a good question. Here he gives the answer. To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. That is a very famous passage. And that verse 8 especially is the most famous part of those three verses. Yeah, He says to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So people want to know, you know, this is what we're asking. How can you tell if someone has changed their mind? How can you tell someone has repented? They have a different attitude and they're real Christians. Well, you look at behavior patterns. And books like 1 John and James, by the way, are devoted to teaching us about this. And a social conscience, you could say, is a fundamental expression of the life of Jesus Christ within us that's real. This is being what God wants us to be. And so that's what John says to the crowd. He said, number one, mercy. Mercy is evidence that we've changed our thinking and we're different on the inside. Now we see this outward action. Okay, that was one thing he said. What was number two? Well, in business, remember there were tax collectors. They were in his audience as well among the people that were coming to hear John the Baptist preach. It says tax collectors also came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? Don't collect any more than you are required to, he told them. In other words, it's not a sin to do what you're doing, even though the Jews would hate them. But you have a job to do, but don't collect more than that. You see, in other words, what he's saying is a change of thinking, repentance, a change in attitude toward God and sin is going to be expressed in integrity and in honesty in our professional lives and our private lives. So the job of, as I said, of tax collecting was open to all sorts of abuse. I mean, these tax collectors had Roman soldiers and Roman army behind them. You couldn't do anything about it. They'd break your legs or kill you, or they can take anything they want. And you can't do anything about it. Those tax collectors were nothing but made men for the mafia. They were just very evil people in many, many instances. And they got rich from it, just like mafia people might get rich off of exploiting people. And so these people often exploited others from whom they collected because it was easy to do it. And people even expected it because this was just the way of tax collectors. And so what does John say? He says, listen, he said, don't do that. Don't collect more than what is required. Yeah, we have to pay taxes to the Roman government. That's what is due. We have to pay them, but don't collect more. And you're not required to do that. That's showing dishonesty. One time Jesus met a man, and he wasn't just a tax collector. He was a chief tax collector. In other words, he was kind of a tax collector over a lot of other tax collectors. And this guy must have been phenomenally wealthy, but he was phenomenally hated as well. And one time he met Jesus. And when he met Jesus, here's how he responded to his meeting with Jesus. Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anyone out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. That's repentance. You see, he was now changing his mind, which was being shown in his change of behavior about money. And this is what this was an encounter with the Lord. And by the way, that's what happens when you meet Jesus in your life. It changes, you see, your thinking about God and sin and the way you express yourself in your life toward others and toward in business. And here's how Jesus responded. He said, today, salvation has come to this house. In other words, Zacchaeus is saved. Salvation has come. You know what? His paying back four times what he took from people that he cheated out of money and taking more money than he should have, That wasn't what saved him, but it was evidence that he had repented. He had changed his mind, and he was putting his faith in Jesus as his Savior. He met Jesus, and that's what happens when people come face to face with Jesus in their lives. You know, a lot of people, they don't want to talk about a personal relationship with Jesus. Well, that's what it is. When you come face to face and you have a personal relationship with Jesus, it's going to change you. It's going to change the way you think. And the way you think is going to change the way you act, what you do. And so a believer must always be the most trustworthy person on earth when it comes to anything but money, you see. Paul would say in Ephesians chapter 6, he says, serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord. We don't work at our jobs or whatever we do like, you know, it's for us. No, we do it as if it's for the Lord, because it is. And that's what Paul told servants and slaves in his day and time. One of the things that shows that we've changed our thinking. Well, what else did John teach? Well, he said a change of thinking shows a change in your attitude toward money. Some soldiers asked him, what should we do? And he said, don't extort money, and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. Now, you'll notice that these two areas are mentioned here, too, their treatment of other people and their professional integrity. But then he adds this about money. He said, don't extort money. Be content with your pay. You see, money finds a new perspective as well when it comes to a change of thinking, when it comes to a change of heart. Sometimes that's the way we talk about our thinking. Paul would say the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. But you, O man of God, flee from all of this. The rich young ruler, you know, we've been talking about the rich young ruler recently. This rich young man came up to Jesus, you remember, fell on his knees. He asked him, you know, what we should do. And you remember Jesus told him, to give away all of his possessions and then come and follow him. You remember that whole story. But you remember this young man wasn't willing to give up all that he had. And he went away sorrowful. And Jesus turned to his disciples and others, and he said, how difficult it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. You see, this man's God, we've seen, was his money. And this is very, very easy for people anywhere in the world to get, you know, involved in, but especially here in America. I don't know that there's ever been a country on the face of this earth that has had people, citizens like we in America, who have lived as comfortable a lives as we do and have as much money to spend. You need to go around the world anywhere. You can go to Europe and see how other, you know, Europeans live, and you'll see we live better than they do. And you go to other areas, and it gets worse and worse and worse. We are extremely wealthy, and our attitude toward God and sin is going to change our attitude and our perspective about money. And that's what he told these soldiers. He said, "Be content. It is the behavior produced by a change of mind that God is concerned with, isn't it? The Lord Jesus didn't just come into this world to enable us to believe properly and get our doctrines right, make sure we got our doctrines all right. But he came on the basis of believing that there would be produced in us a behavior pattern that pleases him. You see, now we think like God does. He wants to change us on the inside so that we'll change our behavior patterns. And so belief in God and salvation It's only a means to an end. The end product is our conduct, our serving him. A change of mind has to produce and facilitate a change in behavior, or it's just denounced as false, and it will be among the wood, hay, and straw that Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 that's going to be burned on the day of judgment. So that's what John taught. Isn't it great? On a changing of mind, a changing of attitude. And so let's look now at some ways that we can facilitate this change of mind. You know, you don't have to just sit back and do nothing. The Holy Spirit guides us. But do you know what that entails? That means that there's got to be movement for there to be guidance. If you're just sitting still, there's no guidance. There's got to be movement to be guidance. And the Holy Spirit guides us, but we've got to be moving. And there's some practical things that we can do to emphasize or facilitate a change in our mind. And I've emphasized this before in other sermons as well, but I'm convinced that it's very important to our living as believers. And I believe that many, many believers are suffering because they don't practice it. But it's a very important practice. And this should be a practice that we do on a regular basis. You know, you make habits of things, and you can make habits of your life as well, good habits as well as bad habits. So what we mean when you can change your thinking by practicing meditation, and by, you could say, healthy things in, and then you're going to be healthy in your behavior. You know, it's they say junk in and junk out, or, you know, garbage in and garbage out. You want to put garbage in your body, you're probably not going to have a healthy body. But if you put, you know, good things in, you'll live better. That's what the evidence shows. Well, the same thing is true spiritually. If you put good things in and your mind is absorbed with good things, then your behavior pattern is going to be better. But what we've got is a lot of people who claim to be believers, and they never really spend much time meditating. There's no really good food going into their mind. It's always worldly things going into their mind constantly all day long. But they expect, you know, that maybe God will accept me, my behavior. Well, your behavior's no different than almost anybody else's out there. It's communion with God. And it's these things that we have to practice. So I want to give you some practical things about how to change our thinking. First of all, we need to ask God to read God's word. You see, it's nutritious things into your mind. You need to think about God's word, meditate upon God's word. And when I read God's word, I try never to read God's word without saying a prayer to myself. Psalm 119, verse 18, you know, open up my eyes so that I can see wonderful things in your word. I want to know, I want to see something really wonderful in his word. And it's him speaking to me. And I'm aware of that the whole time. So if you want to change your thinking, you know, read God's word. And I highly recommend that you do what the psalmist did, pray and ask God to bless your reading. And then one thing that I say frequently, if you're around me very much, and that is read slowly. Don't read. A lot of people want to get through the Bible and read it, and I'm all for that. But you need to read through it slowly. Because if you're like me, at least, I can't read quickly and appreciate a lot that's going on. It's like poetry. You can run through poetry and read the words and lines, but you may miss a lot of the subtleties of it and the nuances. And God's word is deep, it's profound, and you might find God speaking to you in very, you will find God speaking to you in very special ways if you read slowly and meditatively. And then use what you've just meditated in praise back to God and in prayer back to God. When you praise God and thank him for something, maybe this word, whatever he has said to you in his word, use those words back to God. That's what people did in their prayers. Some of the greatest prayers I could show you ever recorded in God's words. God's word are simply just a reiteration of, you know, scripture when you examine them. Mary's great prayer in Luke chapter 1, it's so filled with scripture. And so use that scripture and pray back to God and praise God, you know, with that scripture. And you can praise God, of course, in your prayers. And so the Holy Spirit will help people who are moving. You got to move. And if this is what you do, is you read God's word, the Holy Spirit can guide you. He doesn't just sit and take over someone sitting still and move them and force them to move. We need to be moving. And we can change our thinking about anything. When you've got Christ indwelling you about sin, any sin in your life, it can be changed. And you can change your thinking completely and change your behavior habits completely when you are a true believer and you practice these things. I met a man, I knew him a few years ago and used to spend, you know, meet him and be with him like once a week and for quite a while. But he told me, and I heard him tell people publicly as well, he said, I was an alcoholic. When I was a young man, I was an alcoholic. But he said, I'm not an alcoholic. He says, I don't care what they say. I'm not an alcoholic. I haven't drunk alcohol for decades. But he's a strong believer. And every week he talks to people about Christ. And he's very solid. He's a very solid man. He said, I don't have any desire to drink alcohol. He said, I haven't had a desire to drink alcohol for decades. He said, I don't even like being around the smell of alcohol. I'm telling you something, I believe him. I believe that man has been changed on the inside. I've had a sip of wine and stuff like that, but I've never drank alcohol either. I've never had a desire for alcohol. And I believe that he's just like me. I don't believe he's had any desire for alcohol. I don't think he does now. And the same is true with all kinds of sins that you might be, you think, well, that person, they've got a drug problem or they got a sex problem or they got this or that. I'm telling you something. When Christ comes into your heart and when you practice these great practices, God can change your thinking to where you don't have a desire for those at all. And just like a lot of people have no desire for example, me, drugs. I've never had a desire to take drugs. I don't have any desire for it. Well, I believe people who have been can change and they don't have any desire for it the rest of their lives because they've turned their life over to Christ and they practice these things and they change their thinking. That's called repentance. They might have been greedy business people, and they changed their whole life. And so it can happen. All right, so this is our sermon on repentance, and I hope that it will help you. I hope, first of all, if you don't know Christ, you come to Christ. Because if you don't come to Christ and you try to change your thinking about sin and about, you're just, it's a Band-Aid approach. You first have to know Christ. You have to have a personal relationship with Christ. And then once that happens, you know, you can practice these things and you'll change your thinking about sin and about God in many wonderful ways. So may God bless you.